that weren't here last week, and then dive into what we're going to talk about today. So we talked about some of the main components of healthy living. Nutrition, exercise, sleep, and stress management. And all of those things that they encompass. For nutrition, it would be water, which I mistakenly called that a micronutrient last week. It's not. It's like literally the best thing that you can do. I mean, Jesus, that was what it was for 40 days, right? Right? Mm-hmm. Okay, so like, it's legit. If you have problems sleeping at night, that would be my number one recommendation. Drink more water. Like, it's that important. If you want clearer skin, drink more water. If you're having muscle cramps, drink more water. Like, it's, you're basically all water and electricity. So fix those two things and you'll straighten a lot of your insides out. Put some lemon in it. Put an orange slice in it. Just, I don't like it either. Buy sparkling water, but, you know, make sure that there's nothing else in it, like natural flavors. It's just like water and, you know, whatever else. I mean, don't, like, just do that, but...
Coffee.
Not water. It's diuretic.
That's dehydrating.
What did you say?
Coffee and any sort of caffeinated tea.
It's got water
tea.
In it.
Right? No, it doesn't count. Tea with without caffeine, like herbal tea, get a thing like this. Water with just a plain tea bag in it that's not caffeinated. Pick a fun flavor. Just change it up a little bit. There, that's that counts. Not even green juice, that's not even water. Proteins, carbs, and fats are macronutrients, and then vitamins and minerals are your little, super important, tiny ones that you get from plant foods and non-plant foods. Exercise does all of these amazing things, improves heart health, brain function, detoxifying effects, improves sleep management, increases your lifespan. My mother used to work nights for Danbury Hospital for like 2 decades, and they say every year it takes 10 years off your, like, it's ridiculous what it does to your circadian rhythms and your hormones.
And we work
and all
nights,
stuff.
Well, I work nights at the hospital as well.
Right, yeah, so I mean, it has to be done.
Drinking Red Bulls all night.
Smoking a lot of
awesome.
Cigarettes, yeah.
Smoking cigarettes and drinking Red Bulls.
Those are organic, right?
We didn't even know what that word meant, or how to spell it. Okay, sleep. I could talk for hours on sleep. It is, again, uninterrupted.
That's tough.
It's really tough.
7 to 9?
So, right, yeah, it's really tough. So, the more you clean up your diet, the more you clean up your environment, everything kind of intertwines. So it's not like you need to go home right now and be like, I need to sleep for 7 to 9 hours. I mean, these are like ideal conditions that you can just set on a shelf, and this is my goal, and this is where I'd like to get for the majority of the week. If it can't be done every single night, that's absolutely fine, but still, that's what you're shooting for. And as you clean out all the other areas in your life, this will be one of the first areas that you see improvement in just naturally, which is really nice, because then you know that you're in the right direction. What did I hit?
Okay. So you think poor eating habits are affecting my sleep?
Absolutely. Yeah. What time of day you eat, what you eat, how much you eat, again,
eating
what time of day
night.
You eat.
I don't eat late at night.
That's good.
Drinking coffee at night.
Well, that would matter.
Not often.
Okay.
Not if I have to get up the next morning, I don't.
Okay.
If I know I have to get some sleep.
Okay. What are you watching before bed? I mean, like, there's a lot that goes into it.
I don't watch anything, really.
You play the
she
harp.
She watches TV, and what she watches, I have no interest in, honestly.
What do you watch?
So I go to sleep.
A lot of different things.
So I go to sleep.
Okay.
But the problem is, I go to sleep. I'm so exhausted. I'm asleep at 9 o'clock, and then I'm wide awake at 1 o'clock in the morning. Because I had my 5 hours. I only need 5 hours sleep.
Okay, and some people are like that, and that's
so
okay.
So if I fall asleep early, I'm wide awake at 1 o'clock, and I toss and turn till 3 o'clock in the morning, and then maybe I'll get a little cat nap before I have to get up at 5 o'clock. It's sick. It's going to kill me. It's what's going to kill me. is sleep, all right, well, so is let's sleep not deprivation.
Focus on that. Let's focus on your nutrition. And like I said,
and you think that's and part that of the problem? Will. Yeah, okay.
Yes, and, okay. And what did I say? What was the very first thing that we did? We said water, right? If you're having problems sleeping at night, it's water. Legit, number one. okay, stress management. This literally encompasses everything. All four of my kids just started talking to me in my head, so like, stress management is like, eat and drink to optimize health. Exercise regularly, whatever that looks like for you. Set realistic goals. This is like, that was like, when I was kind of diving into this a little bit, I was like, yes, that's a very good stress management technique to set realistic goals for yourself. Because if you're setting these ridiculously high, unobtainable things, like I am going to cook a great dinner for everybody, get all the laundry done, and clean my house, and prep for school tomorrow, that like that's not realistic. reduce triggers, that's also very helpful. Examine your life and live by your values. So if it's really important to you to get up and read a passage or meditate in the morning, like that needs to be something that you set your life up around in order to have a connected, grounded way about you throughout the day. That's really important to anchor in that way. Set healthy boundaries. Like drinking water on a regular, like you could say that that's a healthy boundary. I'm going to do that for myself and set that boundary that I am only, that I'm going to drink at least this amount of water for, you know, the next week or so until we meet again. Like just, oh, I hit my, did you see that? That was good.
Funny bone?
Yeah.
I got a question for you.
Yeah.
What is too much water? Is there such a thing?
Yes.
Yeah, I mean, if you watch TikTok, yeah.
Because they said for the person around my age and my height, it's like 8 cups of water.
Okay.
Because sometimes I drink more than it. Is that okay?
Or yeah.
Don't they say past the body weight?
Sure. I mean, there's a lot of different formulas. Yeah. I can get, I'll check out what functional medicine has to say about it and then get back to you on that. But, yeah, I mean, I wouldn't follow one of those TikTok challenges where people were, like, killing themselves because they were down in, like, huge crystal rock bottles.
Yeah.
Yes.
I wouldn't go that far. I mean, if you're getting up multiple times a night because you have to pee because you're, like, consuming so much water throughout the day, if it's interrupting your life at all, like, definitely not. But, like, I mean, walk around with a water bottle. You know what I said? praying, that we know, that. Right? I
have a lot to say.
Pay attention.
I'm in that Soul Focus. Sisters Thursday night book club thing, and we learned about lamenting, and I didn't realize that like lamenting was something that you could just totally go to God and like just brain dump and like blah 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 blah, and I'm like, oh my gosh, that's so helpful, rather than doing it to like your spouse or a friend or something like that. So I love that. Thank you for laughing. I mean, it was really helpful. I'm like, yes. have and serve a community and a hobby, which is really helpful, especially if you have a really busy life. I mean, I'm talking definitely about myself here, because it's like you get caught up in everything that you do during the day, especially if you have little children. Like, you lose that identity and being able to do something like, oh, this is me, and I like this, and nobody else likes this. And if they do, that's cool, but like, no, this is me. And doing that is really helpful for stress. Principle one, we talked about eat only substances God created for food and avoid everything else. Fat versus fat. We talked about the fat of animals is a, especially in nowadays with conventionally raised animals and all the antibiotics and GMOs and all of the inappropriate, like they feed these cows, for example, corn. Forget the fact that it's genetically modified. What do cows eat?
Grass.
Right, like, but that
was... And that's where they're supposed to be getting the protein from, that is supposed to be in the meat, where everybody's like, oh, you gotta have meat to get protein, right? Well, they're not even really getting protein anymore, they're not eating grass. And that's where the sugar. Protein comes from, because we saw that video last time about all protein comes from plants. All protein comes from plants, and then the animals eat the plants,
right.
And it's basically just recycled plant protein that's in them. So now they're eating all these grains, now they're GMO grains that are sprayed with all these pesticides, and we learned about the glyphosate, and then that gets into meat, and then you eat the meat, and then it gets into us. And it's just a vicious cycle.
So the heavy concentration of things that gets stuck in the fat of animals is like you're taking a super pill, a super high overdose of everything that that animal was ever exposed to in its life is then going inside of you and becoming part of your being. And versus fat, talking about like the fat of all things full of marrow. Like olives and grapes, like olive oil. I'm talking about, you know, how I explained cold pressing olives to make olive oil is what this is talking about here being a healthy fat. Avocado oil, olives, those are really healthy fats. Coconut oil, really healthy fat, as opposed to the animal fat. And then, like, again, you know, eat only substances God created for food and avoid everything else. Twinkies are not a food. So just avoid them. Like, no devil dogs, like none of that stuff. Like that's also
stuff we grew up on. Stuff I grew up on.
Devil dogs were like, I love
Susie Q's.
Ding dongs.
Because a banana has a skin, is that considered good?
Absolutely. Anything that
because
needs
it's
sun,
inside of the yeah.
Anything that needs sun or water to grow or has like a mother.
But I've been told that bananas can be fattening.
You are going to hear a lot from other people.
Avocado.
Cancel out everything that you're hearing from other people and just focus here. Okay? Just focus here. Don't, like, because there are 1,000 ideologies out there.
Yeah.
And I get it. My mother is, like, going through some healing journey of her own, and she's, like, one minute she's doing this, and then the next minute this guy's telling her not to do that, and then this one's telling her this, and this one... I'm like, just, it's white noise. Like, listen to what I'm saying. That's it.
Yeah. And we talked last time about, like, how, like, the enemy being big corporations, mm-hmm. all these big food corporations that only, like, worry about profit. They use confusion as one of their main tools. So they like to confuse the public. Like, they can't prove, obviously, that their food is any good. So what they do is they come up with these conflicting studies and reports that go against, you know, what a plant-based doctor or a doctor who knows what he's talking about, like, says, and then they'll come out with a conflicting report, you know, that they did, their own stuff. You know, the dairy industry comes out with how milk is good for you, and how milk builds strong bones. So you get these conflicting reports, and you get confused, and then you can...
But that's what the enemy does, right? Okay, are we good? Okay. Principle 2, eat foods that were created before they were changed into something humans thought were better. We're gonna definitely dive more into GMOs today, but processed food, manufactured food, treated and farm-raised being fish, you want to get sustainable, wild-caught everything, stay away from anything that says farm-raised, like don't buy it. Treated would be things that I have a 2021, the EWG is the Environmental Working Group. They come out every year around April with a new, you know, date one, baz it around, with a new Dirty Dozen and Clean 15 list. So these are things that if they are on the Dirty Dozen, you want to only ever buy them organically. If they're on the Clean 15, hey, it's okay, not... So many, like, glyphosate would not be found in high parts per million on any of those things that are on the Clean 15.
Although, I mean, we do recommend, if you can, buy everything organic.
Yes, because on here it says sweet corn, for example, on the Clean 15. And that would be because this is only testing residues on the skin, and as we learned last week or 2 weeks ago, corn and soy are listed as insecticides in and of themselves because the GMOs, the genetically modified part of them, has made them into an insecticide. So no, it's not necessarily that they have a bunch of toxins on the outside of them, they are toxic in and of themselves.
So
that's why it's on here. So again,
There is systemically.
Buy organic, but this is just a nice thing to have so that, you know, you don't.
So the clean are the ones that you don't have to technically buy organic?
Except for corn.
You're still encouraged.
Yeah, definitely don't ever buy corn if it's not organic anymore. Sorry. Yes.
So I've heard that if it's organic, it's non-GMO.
Correct.
Yep.
Whether 100%. 100%.
So then, like, for example, because I have a lot of kids, I have to buy bulk. I love Costco. Now, Costco has organic cucumbers.
Mm-hmm.
They're fantastic. And they have non-GMO bell peppers, not organic.
So, organic and non-GMO. 100% organic, non-GMO is your alpha and omega. Then organic, then non-GMO. That is the order of operations and how I would purchase things. I personally don't buy peppers conventionally grown because of this. Because it's not just the GMOs. Can you shut those doors? Thank you. It's not just the GMOs that you want to stay away from. It's also this. It's also the high contaminants of artificially, chemically produced insecticides, pesticides, herbicides, fungicides that they put on this stuff in addition to genetically modified fruits and vegetables. I know. We buy bags like the mini bell peppers.
Yeah.
Girl, honestly, go to Whole Foods.
Well, that's where I go normally, but I'm telling you, Costco is so much.
I know, but not for peppers. No, not for produce. I have not found that. You may have, but I
haven't. No, I go to usually once a week. I buy all my vegetables and fruits, but it gets expensive.
But I tell everybody to go to Whole Foods because their peppers are like $1.49 a pound for organic. I buy just bags of them. But like in town here, I'll buy just the bags of the mini ones, and I'll buy like 3 bags of them, and that's like $12. But I have like, you know, bags and bags of peppers now. Yeah, go ahead.
Can you repeat again what you said up organic?
Well, watch a couple movies on it. It's 100% organic, non-GMO would be like at the top.
If it's organic, it's non-GMO.
And then underneath that would be just organic.
Okay.
And then non-GMO. This is like the order of ways that you want to look for things that have labels. So 100% organic, non-GMO would be the best thing to buy. If you can't find that, then go to organic. And if you can't find that, then please buy non-GMO. And if you can't find that, then you are on your own.
And I have to have a farm.
Yeah. Go ahead.
So I shared with people in my office what we learned 2 weeks ago, our first group meeting, because it was really shocking and enlightening. It was wonderful. And I was sharing it with in my office. And a very good question. Is there a watchdog to make sure that what they say is organic is really organic?
Oh, yes. Yes, absolutely.
Or not?
Yes and no.
I mean, they can lie.
It's really difficult to get an organic label, but it needs to say, like, certified by somebody. Like, there's always third parties that come in and do the certification. If it's the USDA organic symbol, then you're pretty good. Their regulations and the fees that you have to pay in order to have that type of a label is really astronomical. But then there's
all these... Because there are people, somebody watching that these companies are not putting fake tags on their packaging?
Like, I won't buy organic strawberries from Mexico. I have a little trust for them.
Yeah. I mean, they're
but it says organic.
Honestly.
But it says organic.
It's fine. I'm really scared to do a COVID test that comes from China. Like, it's okay.
Yeah.
Like, it's okay.
Yeah, but it says organic.
Yes.
Well, that's what I'm talking about.
The FDA does regulate it, and there is a bunch of stuff you have to go through to get the certification.
Right.
It's really tough. But, I mean, who's to say that farmer is going to just say, I'm going to just use this pesticide. You know, and there's really nobody watching. But
right.
for the most part, if they're organic growers, these people are committed. Like, they're committed to growing organically. It's like they've made the decision. They're like, I'm not doing conventional. I'm not using all these pesticides. Like, they want to grow good food, and they're like part of the movement. So
there are people.
So I definitely I trust most of them. I mean, the best thing to do in the summertime is to buy local
at the farmer's market.
Right. Buy local if you can.
Because then you're gonna just ask the farmers, what do you put on your stuff, and they're right there in front of you.
But you can't always do that, you know, through the wintertime. So
who lives in New Milford? We have an amazing farmer's market. It runs from like the very end of March or beginning of April, like all the way through the weekend before Thanksgiving. So you're only going a couple months out in the wintertime without. And, you know, then you go to Whole Foods or your local grocery store. But that's like the best
and
place.
And the price, I mean, they're not bad. And like, you know, the question about cost always comes up too. Like, oh, it's so expensive, so expensive. And I just tell people, like, what would you rather spend your money on? Like, good quality food that you're putting in your body to make your body be the most optimal machine it could be? Or are you going to spend it on a new iPhone or a new, you know, material?
Or medical bills.
Right, you're going to pay
well,
now, so
this,
you're going to pay
from
now.
From the food that's killing you.
Right, exactly. So this, I look at it as, this is my health insurance. This is what I spend my money on. I have not had to utilize a doctor in a ridiculously long time. I actually had have Lyme's disease, and had a, after my son was born, I got triggered with something, probably having a baby, and I developed a Bell's palsy. Mm-hmm. And it was really interesting.
That's good.
And I went to my primary care, who I do have one, and she wanted to put me on prednisone and antibiotics, and I was like, well, hold on a little bit. So I went to a naturopath and went back to my own studies, and I ate a ridiculously difficult diet. It was zero sugar, sprouted living food, like raw garlic, oregano oil. I don't know if anybody's into essential oils, but like oregano oil straight up and
hot oil.
It's like,
oil.
I can do frankincense, no problem, but that one will like grow hair on your chest. Yes. But it kills everything.
You weren't
like,
having babies eating raw garlic, I guarantee that.
No, it was after. It was right after I had my son.
Raw garlic.
Within a week and a half, my Bell's palsy was gone, I never touched a pharmaceutical med. And my doctor was calling me like, "Are you crazy?" And I'm like, "Well, you know, no, I'm not, because I worked really hard on my gut flora, and I don't want to vomit, and I don't want to put a really high steroid in me if I don't need to. So yeah, no, that's like complete last resort for me. Like if I am, that's last resort. Like that's not first line." Like, natural medicine needs to be first line, because that has so many detrimental side effects that it will take you months to dig out from being on an antibiotic once, if not, like, if you can ever replace what you lose by taking that. So there's a huge risk in taking things like that. So that was...
Yeah. We'll get into gut flora and, like, the millions of bacteria that are in your gut that you need. And taking one dose of antibiotics kills... not just bad bacteria, but good bacteria, and it takes, I think they said this last time, to like over a year, sometimes 2 years to build all that bacteria back up. And you may not even need to take a dose of antibiotics. If you're drinking milk, right, with all the antibiotics they feed the cows, or if you're eating conventional meat with all the antibiotics that are in the meat, you're getting low doses of antibiotics.
Constantly.
Every time. So people are like, oh, I don't take antibiotics. But you're taking antibiotics, you just don't realize it.
Now, the dirty 12 is better to eat than processed food.
Correct. Yeah.
So,
yeah, no, correct. Yeah. But, which poison would you want? Like, I mean.
Unless they're organic.
Bio-organic. It's the safest way to go. And if you're talking about like a dollar difference on something, like when you put that into perspective, like hold two peppers in your hand, one conventional, one not, forget the taste and the color and all of the stuff that's in the organic one compared to the conventional one. But you know, like people get stuck on price, like he said. But when you think about everything that's in that conventional pepper and how much you're losing from your body as opposed to gaining from eating something like that, I don't think it's a comparison.
I mean, the goal, one of the goals is to detoxify, you know, almost first, you want to try to detoxify your body before you start putting the good stuff in. Pastor Frank talked about, you know, detoxifying your mind, detoxifying your body before you put the, I think he used the couch analogy, like you wouldn't, you know, you want to take the old couch out, you want to put a new couch on top of an old couch. Kind of the same idea. So you want to detoxify your body. And if you're eating these dirty vegetables, you know, and you're cooking them, so you're killing all the enzymes, you're getting rid of probably half the minerals and vitamins in them, and they're heavily treated and sprayed, I mean, are you really doing yourself any good?
It's better than a Twinkie.
Yeah, it is.
But, I mean, I don't want to really compare those two. Go ahead.
Oh, I had a question. Why do doctors, I know you, I saw in the video on YouTube, but why they don't have, or none of the insurance, or the majority don't cover sensitively home blood tests for? And
for what kind of blood test?
It's a sensitivity for gut or food. They don't cover it.
So we spoke about this a little bit last time. Our country, the world's economy is basically set up around healthcare. Food supply, disease care. Food supply and healthcare, which we can call disease care, is what runs our economies. So if there is a sure thing that goes against that paradigm, they're not gonna support it. Because who's in control down here in this reality anyways, right? So it is a fallen world, and this is really how big it has fallen. Like, people don't see it.
Yeah.
You are now seeing it. It is it's bad. Like, what is happening down here is bad.
Yeah.
Goosebumps, it's like.
Yes, because I don't know if maybe all of you are, like, I don't know where to start. I start doing this cleaning stuff, but then something else comes in my body that I'm like, oh, what is this? Like, and then, you know, I'm like, when I ask the doctor, like, oh, it's just this, go ahead. Or just do a sugar level test. And I'm like, no, I don't think that's that.
Do you have a naturopath? So there, you can see a naturopathic doctor. I know functional medicine doctors are ridiculously expensive, but I know like the Sophia Natural place down at Four Corners, I see them right now.
Okay.
It's like $60 to walk in and, you know, have blood drawn and sit and talk to them. And this is the type of medicine that you're going to get. You're going to get, you know, like supplement recommendations and things that the world that you want to be tapped into. If you go to a primary care Western medicine, it is a pharmaceutical pill-based model, and that's it. There's a disease and there's a pill, and it's about managing chronic diseases and not curing them. It's how they're taught. It's not their fault. It's that's how medical schools are designed to support the paradigm of the world economy being, you know, food and healthcare driven.
Yeah. And they get six to 10 hours of nutrition training.
Less than
that,
4 to 6.
Their whole residency. Their whole,
and it's based on the food pyramid.
Mm-hmm.
Like the government put out food pyramid,
mm-hmm.
not like a good one.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, GMOs. I was going to jump into wheat and sugar, like this week and next week, which I will do, but I really wanted to seriously hammer in the genetically modified stuff. So we have a bunch of clips set up to watch today and some lectures in between. We are gonna go into principle 3, hopefully, and touch on that a little bit. And wheat will be definitely coming up here soon, but I definitely want you guys to understand and then be able to go to the grocery store. We watched this, so we don't need to watch this.
That was really good.
Yeah, he's great, right?
Hi, this is Jeffrey Smith. I'm the executive director of the Institute.
Hello, Jeffrey Smith. Do you know who he is?
That's Josh.
Yes, it is.
Hey, listen, guys, I gave him a book to read. You want a great book? Buy Eat Dirt. It's a great book.
He is the author.
Yep.
What is it again?
It's called Eat
Dirt.
Eat Dirt by Dr. Jeffrey S.
Josh.
Josh.
No. No, it's all about how we kill all the good stuff in our guts, and that's where everything starts from.
So I have a couple slides or clips talking about how to eat a non-GMO diet, and then the next one will be actually going into the 15 or 10, 12 or so items that are genetically modified and what that looks like on a label, so that when you go and you do buy stuff that's in a box, you know what you're looking for and you know what not to buy. So I felt like we really needed this.
We're going to try to not only tell you like what's bad, but we're going to also give you some guidance as to like what to eat, like what to shop for, how to shop, how to read labels, you know, what you should be eating as well. So
hopefully we can get to that part. Maybe we need to start at 6:30.
Number of diseases. So let's jump in though and talk about this on GMO diet. If somebody is going to go GMO free, some of the biggest foods they want to stay away from are corn, canola, and soy. Now, of these three products, what percentage, if somebody goes to the store, what percentage of these products today in the United States are currently genetically modified?
Well, in the corn field, there's 93%, 94% of all the corn planted. A
wow.
Smaller percentage of corn on the cob, but nonetheless, there is corn on the cob. 95% of canola, 93% of soy. So it's, if it is a product that comes from lots of soy and or lots of canola, like soybean oil or corn oil or high fructose corn syrup or soy lecithin, if it doesn't say non-GMO or organic, you can assume that it is genetically engineered.
Wow, that's huge.
Yeah.
So anytime you're out there buying or shopping, you know, at any, even health food stores sometimes, I mean, it's crazy to me sometimes. It's a lot better now, but especially even 5 years ago, you would buy a product with corn in some health food stores, and you need to look for that non-GMO label or certified organic label that's on something. But again, if when you're reading on even products that call themselves natural, if you're shopping at your store and you're buying these granola type bars, people need to look and see if there is corn, if you have canola, if you have a soybean oil, any of those products in there, 99.9% of the time it's genetically modified if it doesn't say non-GMO, certified organic on the label. So these are some big ones to stay away from. Let's talk about this. Buy foods labeled GMO free. Now, when did this start, Jeff? Because I know you're a big part of really pioneering this, of actually people putting that on the label. And I don't want to get too off track, but I'd also like for you to mention, you know, today people don't have to put that it's GMO on the label. Why is that?
Yeah, 64 other countries require labeling if a product is genetically engineered.
How many?
64.
64 other countries, and the U.S. isn't one.
Not one of them, no. It's because the U.S. government is promoting GMOs. In fact, the White House under the first Bush administration told the FDA, promote GMOs, so they created a new position for Michael Taylor, Monsanto's former attorney, Monsanto's the big GMO company, to be in charge of policy at the FDA. And when Michael Taylor was in charge of the GMO policy, he said, we don't see a difference between GMOs and non-GMOs worth worrying about. No safety testing is needed. No mandatory review by the FDA needed. No labeling needed. Monsanto, who told us that Agent Orange and PCBs and DDT were safe and got that wrong, they can determine if the GMOs are safe, put it on the market without even telling the FDA or consumers. And
wow.
So that pro-GMO attitude is why we have GMOs on our plate, and it turns out 7 years after that policy came out, a lawsuit forced the FDA to turn over its internal memos on GMOs, and the whole thing was based on a lie. Not only were they aware that GMOs and non-GMOs were different, it was the overwhelming consensus among their own scientists that they were different and dangerous and that studies were needed. And so the entire policy was not based on science, but on industry manipulation and political collusion, unfortunately. And that's why it's on our plate.
You know, Jeff, it is crazy to think the government and some of these other people, they're making money from this. I mean, that's what it all stems from. When you look at the food industry or the agriculture industry and the pharmaceutical industry, I mean, these groups are making money, profiting, unfortunately, off of making other people sick, cutting corners in nature, and it really is, it's really upsetting. I know this is why you're one of the most passionate people I know and out there on a mission. We would ask you, hey, be on the mission with us. If you are like myself and Jeff, and you believe that GMOs should be banned or at least labeled on the food so we know what we're eating, take a minute right now, help us share this video, punch that share button, click that like button as well. So buy foods labeled GMO free is important. Next one here, shop for organic foods. You know, Jeff, how much has organic grown, and why do you think it's growing so much today?
One of the reasons why organic is growing so much is that people are trying to avoid GMOs, and they know that organic foods don't allow GMOs.
Yeah.
Now, I want to contrast a non-GMO label with an organic label. Organic is more important. It's the number one choice, because you can be non-GMO and still be sprayed with things like Roundup and other toxic insecticides.
Wow.
So you can have a non-GMO loaf of bread made of wheat, and 3 to 5 days before the wheat was harvested, the farmer may spray it with Roundup in order to dry it down, to desiccate. It's a desiccant, a dry down, and then it ends up in the wheat, which is not a safe thing for us to eat. So the number one choice is organic. The number two choice is non-GMO.
Got it.
Now, sometimes you'll see organic and the non-GMO project verified label on the same product. That's actually the gold standard, and here's why. Organic does not allow GMOs, but it doesn't test to see if contamination has occurred. So if you grow it according to organic standards, you can sell it. It's supposed to be non-GMO, and people will buy it. If you get non-GMO project verified, it has to be tested to see if any contamination has occurred. So if you have organic and non-GMO project verified, not only does it have all the goodness of organic, but it also has been tested to see if there's any GMO content in any at-risk foods. And so that would be the gold standard. Then organic, then non-GMO, then you're on your own.
Well, I love it, Jeff. So these are great points. So Jeff talked about gold standard, organic, non-GMO verified, looking for both of those labels on the food you buy.
Okay.
That was it?
Yeah. Not on that start, stop feature.
Yeah, so like he was saying, like the wheat, they spray like wheat and all that stuff, they spray it like days before they harvest it to dry it down and do all this stuff to it, and then they harvest it. And it still could be non-GMO.
Number of diseases.
So you're like, oh, it's non-GMO.
No, not you, I was talking to him.
It still could be non-GMO wheat, but it's heavily sprayed with Roundup, and it's got all that glyphosate and all that you know, all the pesticides and herbicides on it. And then you're eating it.
Ready for the next one?
Mm-hmm. Okay. Hey guys, Dr. Josh Axe here with Jeffrey Smith. Welcome to Ancient Medicine today.
Oh, come on, Jeffrey.
Today we're going to be talking about the top 10 GMO foods you've got to be aware of. In fact, we say top 10. We've got three bonuses that are going to shock you. They're actually new GMO foods on the market that you probably don't know about that we'll share with you here in just a minute. And hey, if you are with us that GMO should be banned, take a minute right now, punch that share button right now. Help us spread the word that food should be medicine, not poison. So Jeffrey, it's great to have you here today.
Just
we're talking about non-GMOs. And if you don't know Jeffrey, he is the pioneer of the non-GMO movement. He's also the founder of the Institute of Responsible Technology. And we're going to talk about some of his revolutionary programs here at the end. But let's dive right in here, Jeffrey, and talk about number one food we want to stay away from that's a GMO is corn products.
Okay, corn genetically engineered 93% of the corn in the United States. A lower percentage for corn on the cob, but if you have corn tortillas, corn syrup, etc., and it doesn't say organic or non-GMO, it is genetically engineered. Now, the corn is engineered to produce a toxic insecticide that pokes holes in the stomachs of the insects to kill them, and in 2012, a published research study shows it can poke holes in human cells as well. It also can be sprayed with toxic herbicides, so it's a combination of a pesticide being produced by the corn and an herbicide being sprayed on it. Nasty stuff. Some recent evidence showed serious gastrointestinal disorders in rats that ate this corn.
Wow, incredible. Next product here is soy. Now, a lot of you know soy was a health food, labeled a health food, in the especially in the 80s and 90s. Today, though, many people are realizing that it causes major hormone and endocrine disruption in the body. Talk to us about soy.
Soy, 94% of the soy in the United States, genetically engineered to not die when sprayed with Roundup herbicide. It makes weeding easier for farmers. They can spray over the entire field with Roundup. It kills all the weeds, but not the genetically engineered Roundup Ready soy with genes inserted into
the DNA. And that's all they're modifying.
Unfortunately, that Roundup gets absorbed into the soybean, and we end up eating the Roundup Ready soy, which can link to, is linked to a lot of different diseases and disorders. When mice were fed Roundup Ready soy for 8 months, they had damage to their testicles, the young sperm cells, the pancreas, the liver, and many other animal studies have shown serious problems. Like in Russia, they fed genetically modified soy to mother rats starting 2 weeks before they got pregnant. They continued to feed them GM soy, and when they gave birth to the offspring, more than half of their offspring died within 3 weeks, compared to a 10% death rate when the moms were eating non-GM soy. So avoid eating products with soy unless it says organic or non-GMO.
Wow, great points there. I mean, it is shocking how damaging GMOs are to our bodies. And they're still out there today. They don't even have to be labeled. That's what we're here for, is we're here to stop GMOs. So, hey, help us spread this message right now. Take a minute and press that share button. Help us spread the word. We're live right now trying to teach people how to go GMO-free. Number three here, Jeffrey, canola.
Canola. About 95% of the canola in North America is genetically engineered not to die when sprayed with either Roundup or other herbicides. When it gets made into canola oil, unfortunately, the herbicides can hang around. So you're maybe eating or drinking stuff that contains large amounts of herbicide, which includes Roundup, and Roundup is a class 2A carcinogen, meaning it may probably cause cancer in humans. According to the World Health Organization, it causes cancer in animals. It can damage human DNA, causing mutations which can lead to cancer. And where it is sprayed in high concentrations, there's high amounts of cancer. Avoid canola unless it says non-GMO or organic.
Next one here, alfalfa. And I'll say, especially when we're looking at 1 in 4 here, a lot of cows, you know, cattle today are fed alfalfa. This might surprise people because typically alfalfa is thought of this as its health food, but it's genetically modified as well.
Right. Not only the alfalfa, but the canola meal, the soy, and the corn are all used as animal feed.
Wow.
So this is where we want to avoid the milk, meat, and eggs from animals that are fed GMOs, so it has to be organic. If you see something that's naturally raised, it doesn't mean it's non-GMO. It could be without antibiotics. It could be grass-fed but grain-finished, grain meaning soy and corn. So you want 100% grass-fed or wild-caught or organic in the animal products that you're eating.
Awesome. Great tips here. All right, number five here, sugar beet. Now, this is a surprising one. A lot of times people might look at the back of a package and say, no soy, no corn, and it just says sugar on it. Can something be labeled just sugar, but actually be genetically modified from sugar beets?
You rarely see the word sugar beet on U.S. packages. It usually says sugar or pure cane sugar. If it says pure cane sugar, it's just cane sugar. If it says sugar, most of it comes from sugar beets.
Wow.
And nearly all the sugar beets in the United States are genetically engineered not to die when sprayed with Roundup herbicide. So you may have Roundup residues. We need to check. Sugar may have enough to cause problems. No one has done the research, but I would say if you want to avoid GMOs, you want to avoid products that use sugar beets.
And of course, sugar itself isn't good in the first place, but then it comes from a genetically modified plant, major issue. And we talked about two of the biggest sources of sugar, corn syrup and sugar from sugar beets. Stay away. Number six here is cotton.
People don't think of cotton as a food, but think of cottonseed oil, which can contain large amounts of the herbicides that they spray on cotton. Now, the herbicide which is sprayed on the Roundup Ready cotton, of course, is Roundup, and they have found the residues of the active ingredient of Roundup, called glyphosate, on feminine hygiene products, on bandages. So we want to be careful when we're applying cotton to our skin. Try and get it organic if at all possible. And of course, avoid the cottonseed oil, and then find that in a lot of processed foods.
Yeah, Jeffrey, number seven here is papaya. Most of the time people think of this as a tropical health food. They don't realize even internationally, or I guess, you know, across the ocean, people are growing GMOs there too. Where does most of the GMO papaya come from?
Either Hawaii or China.
Wow. Okay.
So it's the only two places where we know of that they're growing genetically modified papaya. Mm. So if it says papaya and it says from Hawaii or China, I would avoid it.
Great tips here. Number 8, summer squash and zucchini. I bet this is a surprising one for some people. I think a lot of people, Jeffrey, have heard a lot of these others, but not this one.
Yes, I'm afraid that our favorite summer squash and zucchini may be genetically engineered. Now, both the papaya, the summer squash, and the zucchini are all engineered to resist viruses being infecting the plants. But a virologist tells me that it is possible that by eating these things, it might create viral proteins inside our body.
Wow.
And if it produces viral proteins that we're consuming, that can potentially suppress our immunity to viral infection. So there's a lot of evidence that viral proteins can do this. They insert genes that produce viral proteins. It hasn't been studied, but the virologists that I talked to are very concerned about this potential danger, which means we'd be more susceptible to colds and other serious viruses.
Yeah, as Jeffrey's talking about here, there are so many side effects, many of which we don't even know about yet, because we're not doing as much testing as we should be.
That's
not
right.
Even near the amount of testing we should be. So again, we're not saying never eat papaya, never eat summer squash. We're just saying when you buy them, make sure they're organic or non-GMO verified or both, even better. Number 9 here,
yes.
Animal products, and this is a big one.
Yes, I mean, even honey can have genetically modified pollen in it, but most people, when they think of animal products, they think of milk, meat, and eggs. So I have talked to people who, when they eat conventionally grown, meaning GM-fed animal products, they react, or their family reacts. And in the FDA files that were turned over on the basis of a lawsuit, they showed that the FDA had a lot of warnings. Their scientists warned their superiors that GMOs might be dangerous, but they were ignored. One set of warnings came from the Center for Veterinary Medicine. And the head of the Center for Veterinary Medicine and the FDA said that the milk and meat of animals that have been fed GMOs carries unique risks. We all know about the process of bioaccumulation. The animal takes a bite of genetically modified soybean that contains herbicides on it, Roundup. That Roundup might be deposited in the tissue, and then every bite that they take, a little more, and a little more, and a little more. So there may be more poison in the flesh of the animal or in their milk than they're normally eating in one bite.
Wow.
So this is an area where we want to pay more attention to avoiding the animal products from animals that have been fed GMOs.
Yeah, one of the things I used to teach my patients, Jeffrey, is that if you are especially shopping on a budget and you really have to focus and say, okay, there are only certain foods I'm going to buy organic. Meat, dairy products, I mean, these are at the very, very top of the list. Now, this one might surprise some people. Talk to us about this. Microbes and enzymes.
Yes, this is a harder one to track because sometimes the enzymes that are used as cooking agents, they're not even listed on the product. They're rarely
Many
listed.
Many of some of them come from papaya even.
Yeah,
yeah.
Papaya and
wow.
Also the yeasts that they create. So the cooking agents, the way to avoid that is to buy organic, which does not allow the use of these genetically modified cooking agents and processing agents.
So Jeffrey, talk to us. There's a few, and this is what we wanted to share with you, and this might really surprise you. By the way, do us a favor right now. People need to be on right now, on our live broadcast, listening to this, because some of the people, viewers out there, some people might have heard of corn, soy, canola. A lot of people, and I would guess 90% of people watching this, have not heard these last two new genetically modified foods. So take it for a second right now, punch that share button. Let's help teach people how to use food as medicine, not poison. What are these last two shockers that are now becoming genetically modified?
Apples and potatoes, I'm afraid.
Yeah. Apples and potatoes.
So here's the reason they genetically engineered apples and potatoes.
That's a clever reason.
So that when you slice them, they don't get brown. Now, they're using a technology which some scientists think is more dangerous than any of the other previous GMOs. It's called double-stranded RNA. I'll make it simple. They put in a genetic code into the crop to silence a gene. The gene normally expresses a protein that causes the potato or the apple to brown. They put in a code that silences the gene. What are scientists afraid of? Well, this code links up with a complementary code in the crop, we have the same complementary code in our DNA. So what if it matches and links up with and silences a gene that we rely on? It's possible that eating the potato or apple could reprogram the expression of our DNA, and I'll give you an example. There was a honeybee honey set of honeybees, part of an experiment. They were fed some of this double-stranded, different double-stranded RNA in a single meal. It was supposed to have no effect. Over the next few weeks, it altered the expression of over 1,400 genes in the DNA of the honeybee. That's over 10% of the genes. What that means is the entire profile of health of these bees could be affected by a single meal. So we are very concerned about this potato and apple.
Yeah.
Basically, if they don't get
brown,
it's no
good. Yeah. Right, because that's what, you know, Americans, that's how we act now. Like, nothing can, yeah, right. Like, my grandmother is a Hungarian, and she is from Hungary. Like, she just moved here recently, and I can hear her in my head whenever, like, my kids want to throw away, like, a moldy strawberry or something. She's like, cut that off! No, eat it! Like, you, like, yeah.
So now we're messing with the divine design of things, the way God designed, you know, vegetables and fruits to be. They're designed that way for a reason. We talked a little bit about it last time. You know, why are they designed that way?
Right. So actually, it's like what's happening when something browns is sort of similar to what happens when your own body forms a scab. Like, it's forming just a protective layer over the exposed area on the fruit or vegetable so that underneath it doesn't
oxidize.
Thank you. And that's the purpose of it. So it's everything has a purpose, right? And no, we just think that they're ugly and we need to get rid of them. And, you know, lemon juice works too, you know. The thing that I wanted to talk about, we definitely don't need to talk about vaccines in this group. However, Gardasil is a vaccine that is like pushed on our children insanely. Now, it's pretty new. I don't know if you know anything about it. If you're interested, go watch a documentary on it. It's pretty horrible, the things that it was a fast-tracked medicine to prevent the spread of cervical cancer. And now they're saying boys and girls, or, you know, girls, but now they want boys to get it as well. So, because of HPV. Why all of a sudden the raise in cervical cancer? Are we wondering? It's, yes, because of a sexually transmitted disease, or maybe it has something to do with the fact that a lot of our feminine hygiene products have got bleach on them, or they're genetically modified cotton. I remember walking into that aisle, you know, a couple years ago, and I'm like, why are there organic? Why is there like a whole organic section? Like, and it's on the top shelf and it's out of view, and I'm like reading it and it says like no bleach, circled, no this, circled. And I'm like, does that mean that, like, you know, the Tampax brand of everything has that in it? And then when I learned about it, it was like mind blowing that this is what is happening our bodies, right? Like, that's like rape to me, honestly. Like, it's in that category because that, I mean, your skin, did you want to?
No. Just how absorbable, I was going to say how highly absorbable.
Are you kidding me? Right.
That area, like, is. And seriously? Your skin in general, like transdermally, and just that's one of the biggest ways you absorb stuff is through your skin. And, you know, think about a tampon that's
right.
Yeah. Made with GMO cotton.
Soaps and bleach. To bleach the cotton,
it's going right into your bloodstream, like
ridiculous. It's morphing your cells right there. Anything it comes in contact with, like, it's just horrible. It's horrible. Right? Yeah. I want to hug you back there. You look. Yeah. All right.
Okay. And then, you know, I talked about you know, how it modifies. It could possibly, and I think it's.
There's no way it doesn't, because what you eat, you becomes part of you on a DNA level. He's talking like a scientist. Like, they can't say anything definitive because they can't. But, like, okay, we can use common sense here, right? Like, it does.
Yeah. So I mean, he used the honeybee example. How many 1,400 genes it affected? You know. And now again, we're trying to play God. You know, we're changing the DNA and the RNA structures of things. It's, and I always think of Jurassic Park and Jeff Goldblum. We took so many, so long to see if we could. Maybe we shopped, and to see if we and ask if we should, But we were so wrapped up into seeing if we could do something. Should we stop and say, should we be doing this? Mm-hmm. But no. It's profit over people, unfortunately.
All the different vegetables they're coming out with, like purple green beans and purple peppers and purple sweet
potatoes. Has a lot to do with hybridization.
Hybridization is different than GMO.
Because it's more of a natural process and it takes time to
and
do that.
And that's what
however.
Old school farmers used to do. They used to take two different
grafting.
Species, or grafting is different, but they cross-pollinate and come up with like the hybrid tomatoes and stuff like that. And that's a natural way of. But GMOs are completely different.
So I said last week, and we'll talk about that. That is very interesting that you brought up. Because I did say last week that wheat is genetically modified. It's not genetically modified like this. And we'll get into that in a little bit, because I know, like, pasta people and stuff like that, like, that's a really big deal. He's obviously Italian. Yeah. That's like, it's in his blood.
No, really?
Looks like he's written out of the Godfather.
Hey, you're all just jokes.
Alright, this one's really short, and I think we have some lecture.
Right, Paisan.
And now the bad news. Roundup is sprayed on oats, wheat, barley, rye, rice, potato fields, sweet potato fields, lentils, mung beans, citrus orchards, grape vineyards, kiwi orchards. It is sprayed throughout our food supply. It is found in its highest concentration, not in GMOs, but in oats. It is sprayed before harvest to dry down the cereals, to force quick ripening, to clean the weeds out for next year, all sometimes 3 to 5 days before harvest. Heavy dose. In oats, it gets absorbed right into the oats. It gets absorbed into the wheat and spread out into the wheat kernel. So you could buy a non-GMO loaf of bread, but be eating glyphosate residues. So the need now is not to simply be non-GMO. The need is to become organic, which doesn't allow either GMOs or Roundup or other chemical toxins.
Okay. So I just wanted to add that in there, because it's not just about the GMOs on things. It's about the chemical glyphosate specifically, that there is now like an $11 billion lawsuit that was just settled because of people with lymphoma. Mm-hmm. What was it? Yeah. Because this is starting to get linked to a lot of different things. I mean, so I just heard a statistic today. The newest studies are showing 1 in 36 children have autism or on the spectrum. 1 in 36. I have a whole household full of them. Like, this is part of the problem. It's not the problem, but it is part of the compounding toxins that we are getting on every level, literally on every level, on a daily basis. This is what it's doing.
I saw a video on YouTube a while back about someone was saying how the leaky gut is linked to neurological issues, which is what it's a stretch, but he was saying basically that he could link it to like autism.
It's not a stretch, it's what is going on. It's completely what is going on. If you heal the gut, anxiety, depression, ADHD, autism, you change a child's diet that is autistic, that's nonverbal, that's eating a crap standard American diet, and you put them on a higher concentrated, good fat, plant-based, good meat diet, and they become verbal.
Right.
It's completely 100% connected, wow, down to it has to do everything with this the embryology. When you were born, or when you were completely first developed, your the vagus nerve in your brain and your gut and how they communicate form in the same mm-hmm. sack of stem cells when you are 5 seconds old.
Yeah, you're saying that you have a digestive brain, I guess.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
They call your gut your second brain.
It's really like your first.
First brain.
Right. Mm-hmm. And then if it's not developed, then it messes everything else mm-hmm. up.
Gut health and nutrition is first line mm-hmm. for everything. For every chronic disease, for every acute thing, that is where you will go first in natural medicine. That is the first thing to do. Because you can't. It's like you're dealing with like muddy water. Like you need to clean out the body and start it running the way that God designed it to run. Mm-hmm. And then you can kind of figure out where you got to go from there. But first you got to get the vessel clean.
Mm-hmm. Yep. They use the fishbowl analogy.
Oh yeah. Right.
The fish is dying. You don't, you know, the water's dirty. You don't keep adding, you know, stuff to try. You clean out the water, right? Start simple.
Did you read it up?
So, vaccine, which you said, I kind of see some change on my older kid.
Mm-hmm.
I was young, I had this child, and they said, you have to vaccinate your kid a lot, or else you can't. And
do
I'm
anything.
Like, okay, so I'm
right.
going to do it. So I'm seeing a change on my kid. When he was young, he behaved, was good, but now he's acting up, but I'm thinking, me, as I don't know if you guys know, but I study nutrition too, I'm seeing a change and I'm like, wait, something's going on. And the doctor says, oh, he's fine. And I'm like, no, he's not. But now I'm changing his diet. Can you think that people with like this autism, all of this stuff, can, by changing his gut, can you think he would change that or any other thing?
Yeah, absolutely. So you weren't here last week. Our 9-year-old was diagnosed with on the spectrum when she was like 3. And that's when we were eating pretty junky diet. Not intentionally, we just didn't know.
The standard American diet, they call it the
SAD
diet.
It's a standard American diet. And within a year, she went into kindergarten having testing on the spectrum, and within a year, I mean, I sent her in with broccoli every day, like that's what she wanted, tomato soup, like organic, everything, no, nothing in a package. Her teachers commended us at her PBT and was like, she's got the healthiest lunch, like out of everybody in the school, including all the way up to the teachers. And by the time we had our next year PBT, they're like, she doesn't actually qualify for being on the spectrum anymore. For per their tests, I mean, it's a diagnosis I'm not taking away from her because it affords her services. But, I mean, yeah, I'm not saying it's going to be like a cure-all, but yes, I mean, we've seen documentaries specifically when she was a 7-year-old or 6-year-old.
Highly autistic.
She ate Goldfish, Piggy's Pizza, and chicken nuggets. Like, that was all she ate, because these children are very difficult to feed. They get stuck on something, and that's it, right? So they took all of her food away. She didn't eat for a couple days, and then when she finally did start eating again, they put broccoli in front of her, and they put, you know, coconut oil in her diet, and they gave her really nutritious meat to eat. And within 2 weeks, this daughter was, she was speaking to her parents. Like, it was, my goosebumps right now are insane, because it was such a beautiful thing to be able to watch. So yeah, it's super powerful. Give the body what God designed it to run on, and watch God heal. Like, watch it happen.
Yeah, and the thing that really frustrates me is that people on the other side will be like, "Well, there's no proof in that, and there's no proof." But there's you know, you can't tell a parent that's been through it. Like, that is the proof right there. And we've seen it with our own eyes.
I mean, they're blinded.
We've seen it with our own eyes.
All right.
One more question.
Yeah.
So I thought I was doing the right thing in the morning, making like a fruit shake with protein and honey, and now I feel like I gotta change.
Don't know.
Things around.
Right now, all I want you guys to just do is when you go to the grocery store, start flipping what you're buying. Start paying attention to this stuff. We're gonna go through this step by step by step. Don't start like, you know, throwing everything out. Go through your pantries. Start pulling out the stuff that on the labels. This is another thing that you missed last week. If you have something in a package, make sure that you know what all the ingredients are. make sure that if you see chemicals on the packaging, like, you know, or just big long words that you have no idea where that grows, like, is that a word or obviously it's not, throw it away. Preservatives, MSG, anything synthetic or chemical based or anything like that, you know, start phasing that stuff out. Start filling your groceries up with stuff from produce. Like, only shop the perimeter of the grocery store. You now know all of the stuff that you should be buying organic. And I mean, I'll give you just a little bit of a backstory. When Martin, I've been a stay-at-home mother for a really long time, but when Martin went from working at Norwalk Hospital to contracting, we had to go on state assistance for a little while. And this is when all of this stuff started being implemented into our lives through the Holy Spirit. And we were completely able to sustain this lifestyle on state assistance. So this is completely doable. Mm-hmm. It's not that easy, but it's not like, I mean, if this is what you're focusing on, and let's get my family on track and let's get my family healthy, like, it you know, God follows you because you're doing the right thing here by even being here. Like, you'll be supported in this, I can mm-hmm. promise you.
And it's a process, like you said, it's a process. It's a journey.
Yeah.
You know? And we're still on it, and we're not perfect.
No.
It's not easy.
So again, this is what the non-GMO Project Verified thing looks like. It's pretty small on stuff. It could be on the front or the back. My kids chant through the grocery store, heck no, GMOs, like they It's pretty funny.
People. Soy's in everything. Because my wife, she had a miscarriage years ago, and they put her on steroids, and the steroids made her soy intolerant and legume intolerant. And it kind of forced her to do what you're saying against her will. And I realized when I would shop for her, like, soy lecithin is in everything.
Yeah. And wheat, too.
Wheat, too, yeah.
Soy.
Do you have to go? Did you say? Okay.
I'm going to stay.
Okay.
I have a question.
Yeah.
On the soy thing, is it because it's all contaminated or soy itself?
So, all right. Maybe we won't get into this and we'll pick up here next time. So, soy, like he said, 94 or 96% of soy is genetically modified. Tofu is a heavily processed substance anyways. It has in it a lot of estrogen-based compounds that resemble things inside your body. That's why people are like, stay away from tofu, it's an endocrine disruptor. If you're gonna eat something like edamame, a whole shell bean edamame, or tempeh, which is a really great fermented like meat replacement. Like, I make tacos out of it. I make a taco seasoning, or I buy a taco packet, like an organic one, because the ones from have MSG and a whole bunch of other junk in it. In the organic section, they have a taco seasoning that has got just, you know, oregano, salt, garlic, cumin, chili, and onion powder, and maybe some paprika. Like, those are the ingredients. Or you can make your own, those are the ingredients. Tempeh, it crumbles like, what do you normally make tacos out of?
Beef.
Thank you. And you put taco seasoning on it. That's a tofu-based.
And I kid you not.
That's a tofu. Like,
you put the toppings on it. You might be able to tell, maybe. I can't tell the difference. I can't tell the difference when you season the tempeh with the taco seasoning, and then you put your toppings on it.
I buy
tempeh.
Tofu.
Where do you buy?
I do buy tempeh. I can. Maybe we'll start. Is everybody on Facebook? Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's okay. I am. You don't have to be.
Okay. I'm not either.
We got on social media for some reasons.
All right, so we'll put pictures of stuff in the resource section. Where do you guys shop?
Shop right.
Big Y.
Okay, Big Y. Anybody at Stop and Shop?
I have a Stop and Shop.
Okay, we live around the corner from there, so their organic section is pretty darn good. They have tempeh in there. I'm sure Big Y would.
I have no problem switching grocery stores. Okay. I do the shopping.
Okay. Yeah.
Every Saturday, I go. I love it. I love going shopping.
We can go. I'll do grocery shopping.
I go every Saturday.
We can do a field trip.
Yeah. I love
to the grocery store.
I would totally do that. Well, and just take you around and point stuff out.
Trader Joe's
will definitely have tempeh.
See, I actually still go to the store. She gets stuff shipped to the house.
That's the safest way to do it. Because then you don't buy.
So that's why I said I do the shopping.
$24.
I actually do the old fashioned.
I love Biscuit Markets. They're awesome.
Yeah. Okay. All right. Any other questions? Can I take 5 more minutes of your time?
Yeah.
Okay. I just want to give you guys something good. We'll go through all of this.
Mills?
No. Escape. Let me just find the slide. It's like, I just want to give you something happy that you can be like, oh, okay, cool. I got a good note, right.
Well, did you make a New Year's resolution to eat right in 2020? I know I did. And in just 1 week, are you already wondering, what should I cook? Well, here's the great news. Dr. Mark Hyman has the answer for us, and it's easier and cheaper than you think.
Dr. Mark Hyman is an 11-time New York Times bestselling author, a physician, and health advocate who has dedicated his life to wellness. He says in order for you to improve your health and stay fit, you have to use food as medicine. In his cookbook, Food, What the Heck Should I Cook?, Mark offers easy, satisfying recipes that not only taste great, but can also improve your body's overall function and keep you fit for life.
And Dr. Mark Hyman is...
Stop! Go!
With us now, welcome to the 700 Club. Great to see you.
Thanks for having me back.
You created the vegan diet. What in the world is a vegan?
Yeah, well, you know, everybody's in a diet war these days, right? Paleo, vegan, keto, low carb, low fat, high fat. It makes people crazy. So I said, listen, the rules of eating are common sense based on science, good science. And so I said, well, if you look at paleo, you look at vegan, they have a lot of common principles together,
right?
Whole foods, real food, fresh food, low starch and sugar, which make people diabetic and pre-diabetic and overweight, lots of veggies, lots of plant foods, plant-rich.
You still have meat.
Not necessarily plant-based, but plant-rich. So 50 to 75% of your plate should be veggies. Lots of good fruits, nuts and seeds, lots of good fats, olive oil, avocado, whole grains, beans, just good animal products that are sustainably raised, that are not, you know, treated inhumanely, and that are grass-fed, ideally.
It's so easy now to get grass-fed beef at any supermarket.
And you can do it online. It's even cheaper, where you can get it for a serving that's less than a McDonald's hamburger.
Well, you say that food really is our best medicine, and so many of us are struggling with different things. And why is that?
Listen, if I had one medicine to use to treat all my patients, it would be food, because it is the most powerful drug. We had a woman, Janice, come to our clinic, and she had diabetes, heart failure, angina. She was, kidneys were failing, liver wasn't great. She had high blood pressure, pile of pills, shooting insulin. She was 243 pounds, and within 3 days, she was off her insulin. In 3 months, she was off all her medications, diabetes reversed. In a year, she lost 116 pounds and got
just
off of everything.
Just by changing her diet.
Yes, but it wasn't a weight loss program. It was just eating this way that we're going to talk about.
And you say that food goes way beyond personal health. What do you mean by that?
Well, I think, you know, we live in a larger context of a food system. So how we grow the food, how we process it, market it, distribute it, eat it, waste it, all that plays a big role, and it's causing so many problems. Chronic disease affects 6 out of 10 people. We have an economic burden of that. On Medicare, we're going to run out of our Medicare trust fund in 6 years. We have climate changes caused by the way we grow food. We have social injustice because of poverty, mental illness, depression, suicide, often have been linked to our diets and our poor ultra-processed diet.
Well, how has the food industry hijacked our kitchens?
Well, most people don't know how to cook anymore. I mean, in 1900, Almost every meal was eaten at home, 2% maybe eaten out. Now it's over 50% of meals are eaten out of the home, and so it's mostly processed food. Even if you eat in the house, it's some packaged processed thing made in a factory instead of home-cooked meals, which are not that hard and which are not that expensive and don't take that much time if you follow some simple principles that we're going to talk about.
And that's true. That people say, oh, I'd love to eat healthy, but it is too expensive. But you're going to say that that is not the case.
No. I mean, I worked with a family in South Carolina who lived in a trailer, a family of five on food stamps, disability. They were very overweight and sick. And I said, look, you can do this. I showed them how to cook. We gave them a little guide called Good Food on a Tight Budget. They lived in the worst food desert in America, and they lost 200 pounds in the first year. Brady, the boy, went on to lose 138 pounds and went to medical school. So you can do it anywhere.
Well, you are going to show us some delicious ways we can do just that. Yeah. Let's start with these amazing pancakes over here. These are gluten-free. Yeah. These are gluten-free. These are blueberry lemon pancakes.
Yes. So to eat good and feel good, it doesn't have to taste bad. Right? You can eat delicious food. Pancakes are so good, and they're not made from flour. They're made from no grain. So they have coconut flour, and they have cassava flour, which is a root, and also eggs, which gives it protein, coconut milk, and blueberries, which is yummy. And you can sprinkle a little maple syrup on there, and it's basically a protein and fiber pancake that tastes like the real thing.
I've had gluten-free pancakes before.
Yeah, they can be bad. They can be bad.
These are amazing.
They are amazing.
I don't miss the flour.
There's no suffering here. I mean, I don't like to suffer. I like good food. I don't want to eat junk. And it tastes bad. Even if it's good for me, right?
And all of these recipes are in your...
Everything's in the food. What the heck should I cook? Book, you can
which
go
we'll get to in a second.
To foodthecookbook.com, and there's all kinds of extra bonus videos and everything on there.
Okay, seriously, those were delicious. And I love how thin they are, too, and I love the blueberries on top. Now, this is for lunch. We have a chili. What kind of chili is this?
Well, this is called Cremini chili. Now, it's a great way to sneak in veggies, right? So it's grass-fed meat, or if you don't want to eat meat, you can put in Cremini mushrooms, which are like meat. Mm. And you have carrots, celery, onions, lots of spices. Spices are the medicine in our cabinet. And then avocado on top, a little cilantro. Super yummy, delicious, very
what
filling and satisfying.
Spices are in this?
Oh, we have chili, we have cumin, we have garlic, we have all kinds of onion powder, just yummy spices.
I love chili, especially in the winter.
Yes.
All right, so I'm not sure if this is still hot, but I'm going to just try the spice anyway, because it's all in the spice, right?
Yeah, it just goes good with the pancakes.
Oh my gosh, I'm serious. That is so delicious.
This is just the way you can actually eat good, feel good, and then do good. You know, if you want to be in service of God, how do you do it when you feel like crap?
What am I tasting? Is it the cumin?
I love
is
it. You said that.
You have to be, you know, some people don't like cumin, but I like it.
Yeah,
and you can really, really taste it. So,
we're going to make some lasagna.
But gluten-free.
It's gluten-free, grain-free, but not taste-free. And a special kind of cheese we're going to talk about. So the first thing we do is we make some Swiss chard. Now, we want to use a lot of greens. Greens are so good.
This is avocado oil.
Avocado oil, which is a great oil to use when you're cooking at high temperature because it doesn't smoke.
Okay.
And it's not like some of the other refined oils. It's much better for you. It's more like the kind of olive oil of high heat cooking.
Right.
And then you just let the pan heat up a little bit. You feel the chard in there. Yep, you feel the chard in there.
Okay.
And you get it all going. And it cooks up really fast. So people say, oh, you know, I have time to cook. But you chop up some greens. You throw a little garlic in there. I should have done that first, but, you know, stuff happens.
Okay, you take over.
All right,
we've only got 2 minutes to take over.
Okay, here we go. Garlic.
Okay, lots of garlic.
A little bit.
I always put way more garlic than they call for.
A little bit of lemon juice.
Yep.
Garlic's a natural antibiotic. It's good for your gut. It boosts your immune system. It actually detoxifies.
We might need to turn this down.
We might need to have smell-o-vision on it. It smells pretty good. So this is all good. Well, that's cooking.
Well, let's start making the lasagna.
We're going to make lasagna. So what you do is you pre-cook these in the oven. You sort of bake them. And then you lay them in strips. You use a mandolin to slice them in nice thin strips.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So we put all that down. So that's the noodles.
Okay.
And then you throw on the turkey chili, which is organic turkey. But you also have a tomato paste in there. And you have, again, all the amazing spices that make it taste good. And then you throw another set of noodles on there. So you're making like a layer cake.
So you don't put the cheese on yet?
No. And then we go Swiss chard. We get to put chard you already cooked to throw the chard on there. Okay, we're making a mess. But play with your food. That's what's so good. Of course, I should be wearing gloves. But
and this is goat cheese, right?
Yeah, so people have trouble with dairy. They have stomach issues. They have issues with with inflammation. It can cause acne and all kinds of
stuff.
So
goat
is a different kind of dairy, which doesn't have the inflammatory stuff and the gut-busting stuff in there. So it's really good. And then we throw another layer of this on.
Okay.
I think we need a deeper pan. We got so much chili. All right, here we go. We got all the layers of chili, and then we put more meat.
I love that it's zucchini instead of the pasta because I love lasagna, but the pasta just makes me so bloated. I just feel really fat.
And this is just full of protein and veggies and spices and
cheese on
top? All the medicine. Yeah, more cheese. Oh, wait, more noodles.
Oh,
more noodles
on top. Okay.
More noodles.
Yeah, we didn't crisscross, you know that. We did it all the same way.
Oh, darn. Okay, well, let's put cheese on. And then...
Now, this is grated goat cheese. I've never seen grated goat cheese in the store, but, you know, but you can grate it.
Yes. Yeah. And then we take this, and we put it in the oven.
Oven. Okay. Let's start.
What do you mean, these? Okay. We're going to put it in the oven.
Oh, we got a hot one. Okay.
And like magic, we've got our chili. Look at that. It's so good. And it's so tasty. It's so yummy.
All right. So
it's also good. And, you know, for dessert, because I know we're in a hurry.
I'm just going to move. We got 30 seconds. So, okay, so, but everybody's going to want to know how this tastes.
Okay, well, all right. Well,
so,
how did they just give you the fork?
I don't know.
Okay, we'll try it.
Yeah. Okay.
Oh, my God.
Okay, I can't. I'll try it. Three wins.
And then, well, four. There's no suffering here. You do get dessert, but you can make it with great ingredients that actually are full of natural sweetness. For example, frozen peaches and frozen cherries are picked at their ripest.
Right.
They're cheaper, and you take them, put them in the oven, bake them with some spices and some flax seeds and almond flour. You take some nuts and seeds, which are full of protein, antioxidants, vitamins, and you roast them in the oven, then you put it all together and put some coconut cream. It's like coconut whipped cream, but without the bad stuff or regular cream. So it's really simple, really easy, and you don't have to suffer. There's no pain, there's no suffering. You get to eat delicious food. And you get to get healthy at the same time, lose weight without effort, and get rid of what I call FLC syndrome, which is when you feel like crap.
Yeah. I want to do that. Honestly, everything was so flavorful. I want to make every single thing that you've made here.
I know. And there's so many more recipes in the book. The Persian cucumber, the slow-cooked lamb. I mean,
yes.
So many great desserts.
Thank you.
So, there. I didn't want to, like, kick you out of here with nothing good to come out of it. So... over there, I took out of my house a ton of cookbooks and some books, but most of them are cookbooks. I don't, if you want to hang around, look through some, take some pictures, you can borrow some if you want. I can't lend out, like, my brand new one that I got, his book, that food one, I won't lend that out because I just got it, like, 24 hours ago, and I love it. I'm going to try and bring this stuff every week so that way, you know, because this is really important. It's like if you're going to start transitioning this way, you need to start, I mean, in Stop and Shop or Whole Foods, like in the aisles, this is where I buy the magazines. They're like $10 each, but they're nothing but recipes. And I put little tabs. I have my kids pick stuff out. What do you want to try? And this is just what you live by because... if not, you kind of go into default mode. So you need to keep things in your reach, within reach, that are easy and that you can lean on that are like 1, 2, 3, go. Right there. So, you know, feel free to browse.
Trial and error, you'll find those recipes that work good for you and your family. So, and there's literally a version, like a healthy version of every dish that you can imagine. You know, we make stuffed peppers out of lentils.
Oh, yeah.
Awesome.
That's really good.
You know, the lasagna you see, you know.
I haven't tried that one. Goat's milk is the closest thing to human breast milk. So that is why it is... Goat milk. I know a lot of people, I heard you, like, my mother's like, bleh.
Yeah.
Goat cheese. It's difficult, I get it. Otherwise, just skip it.
My husband loves it.
I love it.
What about raw cow milk?
Again, where are you getting it from? I mean, if you're driving to one of the places at Roxbury, okay, yeah, fine. He had all the time. I hate it. It's not good. No, I mean, honestly, it's not. So, like, the purpose of cow's milk is to grow a baby cow into a big cow. It's not to grow a human into a human. Like, grown-ups are grown up. Like, they don't need to grow anymore. So giving them heavy lactose sugar-based milk is nothing but an addiction and a societal norm that's not normal, because there's no other animal on earth that goes up to a different animal and drinks its milk.
Yeah.
It just doesn't exist.
No.
So
Martin said it great 2 weeks ago. Yeah. We're the only people, we're the only mammals,
who drink someone else's excretions of another mammal.
That makes it sound really gross.
Yeah, it does.
And even with raw milk, you're still getting the growth factor in there, the IGF, which any disease state, especially cancer. That's why they tell anybody with cancer they should be off dairy.
Well, they don't say that, but in this world they say that.
Anybody that's on, has cancer in any disease, they should have consuming any dairy. Because it has the growth factor in it, and it's making cancer cells grow as well. Cancer feeds on sugar, and cancer feeds on IGF, the growth factor is in dairy. And you know, it's a shame that Susan B. Comer,
Coleman. Yoplait.
Her biggest sponsor is Yoplait. So, that's in What the Health is a great documentary. And it exposes, it's just that the ties in just our government and just the whole.
You get to see behind the veil on that one. Follow the money. It's pretty insane.
The whole ugly truth about it.
Any questions?
You know, another book that has good recipes is the Daniel Fast book.
Oh, okay.
They have some really good recipes, because it's all about eating from the earth.
Nice. All right, cool.
And that's God-based, so.
Is it Christian Colbert? Have you ever heard of him?
Mm-mm.
He's a Christian doctor who has a lot of good books out about all this stuff, too.
Cool. That's where I got the principles from a Christian-based doctor, Rex Russell.
What the Bible says about
healthy eating. Any questions? I promise we'll get out of this topic next time. it's a really big deal. And what it does to your physiology, like, if you understand the why, then when you go to the grocery store the next time, it's going to be very hard for you to not choose the right thing. Like, Jesus says the way is narrow, and this is narrow. Like, because the grocery store is like, hi, buy me Doritos and this and that and Coke, and that's why they put it right by the front door in every grocery store. Like, they don't stick carrots there. So, I mean, it's narrow.
It's the easy path. And this is the hard path.
It's the way of the world.
Yeah, it's Matthew 7:14. It says, enter through the narrow gate, right?
Oh, look at you.
Enter through the narrow gate. Wide is the gate, and broad is the road that leads to destruction.
Yeah.
And many people follow it, right? And that's, with food, it's the same thing. Everybody just follows the easy way, right? But small is the gate, and narrow is the road that leads to life. And very few people find it. It's not as for people.
You could also say, why is the gut?
And I think that we are the few.
Yeah.
You were blessed to be here, to be able to talk about this stuff, to be able to have this information. It's like, yes, I was picked for the team. Like, yes.
And we'll get a list of documentaries together and cool books. And we have a lot of books.
Please check out the books.
Not just diet, not just food and cooking books, but just books that all these doctors have written that are just great books.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So 2 weeks, every 2 weeks, not next Monday, but seven.
Sometimes I lay under the moon. I thank God I'm breathing. And I pray, don't take me soon, 'cause I am here for a reason. Sometimes in my tears I drown, but I never let